Broadcasting.
Welcome, everyone. My name is Roger Durling. I'm the executive director of the Santa Barbara International Film Festival, and I'm excited about today's conversation with writer-director Alice Wu, whose latest film, The Half of It, just premiered on Netflix and has deservedly received unanimous rave reviews. Peter Travers from Rolling Stones magazine says Alice Wu's sweetly subversive rom-com about a closeted Chinese American girl searching for love and finding a healing friendship is an exuberant gift of a movie that is just the tonic we need in these troubled times. And I couldn't agree more. So, but before we start talking to Alice, let's take a look at the trailer of the film.
Give it up next for Ellie Chu.
Chugga chugga choo choo!
The good thing about being different in a town like this is that no one expects you to be like them. I'm 17. I live in Squamish with my dad. I run a business, writing essays for people. I guess I just never thought I'd need anyone else.
Hey, hold up.
$10 for 3 pages.
No, I'm not trying to cheat.
What's this?
A letter. Maybe you can make me sound smart.
Dear Astor Florence, I'm in love with you.
Ooh. These hallways were murder.
I'm Ellie Chu.
Yeah, I know.
You want a letter about love? I'll write you a letter about love.
Hey, she wrote back.
We can do this. Ask her to hang out.
Come on, dude. You messaged me?
Yep.
Conversation is like ping pong. I hit one, and then you...
What the...
Oops.
Where were you born?
In Squamish.
What do you like about Squamish?
I've never been anywhere else.
Me neither. What do you like about Astor?
She's pretty and smart. What else could I like about her?
I don't know. How her eyes look right into yours. How you can live in an ocean of her thoughts and she really knows.
I'm so stupid.
I just meant...
You like Astor? Hey, it would suck to have to pretend to be not you your whole life.
I gotta go.
No, wait.
Choo choo!
Who you calling choo choo?
What?
You know what it's like to finally meet someone your age who gets you? Love, it's not finding your perfect half. It's the trying and reaching and failing.
Ali, she's sad. No, you don't see her. Who she is? Who she could be?
Well, welcome, Alice. I have to start with the question that I've been dying to ask you. I'm a big fan of Cyrano de Bergerac, the play, and the big moment in the play is the balcony sequence. And when I saw your film, it took my breath away, the moment in the diner, because you actually composition-wise, recreate a sense of the balcony and the texting back and forth between Ellie and Paul, recalling the balcony scene between Cyrano and Roxanne. Can you tell us about how you arrived at that moment?
Yeah, I love the, to be honest, I wasn't even thinking of the balcony scene anymore in terms of visually, but certainly that in that the plot, there is that moment where essentially, you know, Ellie is puppeting, you know, is sort of in a way puppeting Paul's thoughts to Astor, right? And because it's modern day and now we're using texting, the main thing I was trying to figure out is when I wrote the script, it's actually a very complicated scene because now there's two different texting platforms being used. There's literally like basic text, which is what Ellie and Paul are like just texting each other on, let's say, iMessage. But then we've created this whole other texting platform for Ellie and Aster to be communicating on. So it's a challenge then when you're framing it for the screen, because you could end up with a visually a very confusing situation, right? Where like, if you think about it, how do you represent that on screen and not confuse people? So when I was like drawing out my storyboards, I was like, okay, I think what I need to do is I need to short side. Like if this is the frame, I'm gonna short side one person facing this way with a lot of room behind them, right? Because I think the only way to visually make it work is if I do that, then I can basically unconsciously let the viewer think, oh, whenever, like when Aster's being short-sighted in the frame behind her, that is Aster and Ellie texting, right? And then when we whip over, whenever we're looking at Paul, whatever's behind him short-sighted is a different platform. And I had to think about it like that, because if you decide, oh, we'll just put text anywhere on the screen that works, people are going to start to be confused as to who's writing who, because you really can't rely on, oh, we see the email handle, right? Like that doesn't, it actually will get confusing if you're reading like this person said, wait, who's writing? So then when I was thinking about it, I was like, oh, the whipping makes it really funny. Like when I was thinking like, if we whip here and then he, like, then it becomes a situation where here Ellie and Aster are talking and they're having this wonderful connection. And then all of a sudden Paul interrupts. So every time we whip over, Paul is basically cutting in and interrupting. And that visually shows what's emotionally going on. And I even said like what to the camera operator, I was like, okay, when like, it should be a little bit like when Paul, when there's a ding, it's like, ah, and then as soon as you're just like, boom, you want to be back here. And it's like, when he's like, ah, we're back here. And then boom, you want it. So that the movement should track Ellie's emotions. Like that's what's happening. That entire visual thing is that, and it's funny, because I remember when I said, like, I hired my DP and I was telling her, this is what I want to do. She's like, that sounds crazy. Like, she was like, I don't know if that's going to work. So of course, you know, there are backups, but I'm like, I really think this will work. And then we cut it together. It was, I think it's like one of the funnest sequences in the film.
It's breathtaking. And as I said, to me, it felt like, because where Ellie is seated, it looks like it's the balcony, you know, she's looking up at Roxanne, and communicating with Roxanne. The other aspect that the framing, and you talked about storyboarding the film, the framing, there's a frame within a frame which fits perfectly with the characters because they seem contained. They seem, you know, there's a sense of entrapment about the way that you framed them. It's obviously you're nodding. That's something that you did intentionally.
Yes. Yeah. No, absolutely. And in fact, it's not just there, but certainly the first time you see Ellie, she's in that engineer's booth, right? Which like there's a lot about, like that booth, I always say that's your safe space. So when you're there, so we use that emotionally, like you, it shows up a few times quite obviously when Paul's like, do you want to go to this party? And she's just like, shuts the door. And it's like in that, you know, like she's in that booth, or when Aster's shown up. And like she, like I'm like, the closer you are to that booth, the safer you are. The further you are from the booth, the less safe you are. And so that like is a, to sort of give the director an the actor an emotional sense of what is happening in the scene. But it's true, when she's in that booth, she's super contained, she's super safe, but she's super limited. So mm-hmm. That's kind of, again, telling the story of the. Mm-hmm.
The other moment that I want to talk about as well, composing is the hot spring sequence where the two of them are swimming, Aster and Ellie, and the reflection of their faces, which harks back about the Plato introduction at the beginning of the film. Can you talk about that?
Yes. Yeah. So that is intentional, as you can see. Like, there's actually a lot of twinning. There's a lot of twinning. There's a lot of triangles, and there's a lot of halves in this movie. Like from places where I'd even put in like pocket dialogue in the background, like when Deacon Flores is teaching in class, like I purposely had him be like, "Someone lost one of our triangles." Like anywhere I could sort of put triangles in, Or in this case, like with the twinning reflection motif, it happens in the hot springs when the two of them are lying there, and that harkens to the opening animation. But it's also whenever you'll notice, like whenever Ellie's like leaned against her booth and she and Aster are texting, there's reflections. Like purposely, I have them both leaned up against glass so you see their reflections. And that's also intentional because I'm trying to create a sense of this whole notion of looking for your other half, right? Like, and we should have this sense, like on some weird level, these people are kind of like soulmates. And yet there's also this idea, I mean, ultimately, I don't want to give away the end of the film, but I think there's also this sense that there also, you also can find that within yourself. So I think the reflections shows that rather beautifully.
Which is very powerful when the three of them are together and Aster walks in on them. You see the reflection on the Coca-Cola mirror.
Yeah.
I love that you, as a director, you help us analyze the story in a visual way, that you're studying and analyzing your composition. So much information has been given to us.
Oh, thank you. Like, I think, I love that you saw that moment and understood it, because sometimes mostly people say like, that was a cool shot. And I'm like, it actually, the intention is, it is interesting that she sees her reflection first. And then when she turns, she sees the reality. And that's when Aster is like so heartbroken and leaves, right? And it's almost like it's a way to sort of shatter like you've shattered the delicate bubble of what these two have been building, right? And I think some of this is very conscious, like that example is one I was thinking of. And some of it is honestly just sort of visceral. Like I think I tend to picture things visually when I'm writing them. And probably even more than visually, I hear them. Like I write to music. And so I tend to create a playlist of specific music that I'd be listening to for specific scenes.
There's a Chicago song in the hot springs, which is so powerful. Was that written in the script?
That was written into the script. I know that was literally half our music budget, but I wrote it into the script and I was like, that is non-negotiable. Like I have to have that song. So I took like on so many other things. I just found, we had the Ruin brothers who are amazing, who I think they're going to blow up, but I have four of their songs in the film, two of them, which they wrote specifically for the film. But that was part of that is they had a certain sound that I really love that, you know, it would have been amazing to, for example, use the Neil Young Harvest Moon song, which is a song that I listened to when I was writing a certain scene, but we cannot afford that song, right? But the Ruin Brothers instead wrote a song that I feel like isn't Harvest Moon, but actually lands a certain depth to our that specific scene that actually works for the scene. But they also have what I love, because they're young guys, they're like 29 years old, right? But they have an old, like, they just have a timeless sound. And I think with this film, I'm playing a lot with sort of old and new, but right. The new is not poppy. Like I'm very against leaning into anything that's the trend of the moment, because I think it dates your film. But yes, I think that in that when I was writing certain scenes, I'm hearing, you know, certain things that inspire me. And then by the time it comes to the directing, I end up hiring amazing people who then elevate it, right? Like I tell them, here's what I'm looking for. And then they take it. Like my DP goes, okay, I get it. You want more twinning. What if we did this? Like it informs her, like when she sets up the camera, it's like, she has a great eye. And it's like, yes, that's it. No, this is flat for me. Like she already knows I love texture. My production designer like knows. I'm a big fan of foreground, background action. So yeah. She knew immediately like, oh, okay, you want that, then we need to, like, she immediately set, like, okay, let's have the Ellie in her dad's apartment. Let's make sure, like, you almost see pretty much the whole apartment in that one shot, right? And I think I love that kind of texture. So these are the things that I can sort of state what I like, but they're the ones who really then build it in a way that I think, you know, I just think they did a really wonderful job.
Incredible job. And I'm obsessed, as you know, about the Hope Springs sequence. The conversation, the fact that Ellie brings up God and not believe in God. It's just such an unusual conversation for two teenagers to have. Can you tell us about, you know, writing that scene?
Yeah. So I'll admit that I tend to write from a fairly emotional and personal place. And at the point I'm writing, I generally feel like, I guess I don't even think this thing I'm writing will probably even get made, right? Like when I made Saving Face, which is my only other film, my first film that came out 15 years ago, and it's like an Asian lesbian romantic comedy, like who thought that movie would get made, right? So at the point I was writing that, I wasn't thinking that would happen. Similarly, because I'd left the industry, by the time I wrote the half of it, like 3 years ago, it wasn't a moment yet that Hollywood was eventually about to like discover diversity in a much bigger way. But the time that hadn't happened yet. So as I'm writing this, I still think like, this is, I'm just gonna write the thing that moves me. Probably it won't get made, but this is like, I guess I write to sort of understand things about the world. And there, for whatever reasons, I personally spend a fair amount of time thinking about whether God exists or whether there's a larger universe. And in my experience with teenagers, teenagers are just people who happen to be going to high school, you know, like they're much more sophisticated than I think we realize. And I certainly know at that age, I was thinking about these things. And sometimes I'll watch movies that are, let's say teen movies, and I'll really enjoy them, but I feel slightly like the teens, you know, either they're sort of clever in a way that doesn't feel human to me. It feels like I'm watching a slightly elevated play, or they're sort of played to be just not, they're played to somehow be not as humanly realized in a way that I experience kids or teenagers. So I guess I just gave them like all the things that I think about and wonder. And I feel like those are the sort, like, especially for characters like Aster and Ellie, where the whole point is these two are trapped in a town that doesn't understand them, and there's nobody else in town who could understand them. I wanted to give them the simplest and most real conversation two people could have in that moment. And for me, I feel like that is something Aster would be thinking about, like, especially because for the first time she's doing something kind of not morally, like it's very morally gray what she's doing, right? She has this boyfriend, she's exchanging letters. Like this is all making her wonder a bit about, is she sinning? What is this, right? And for Ellie, like I think it's the deep revelation of like for her, in some ways I think does God exist or not exist is sometimes very tied to our notion of our parents. You know, like I definitely grew up, I adore my mom. Like anyone who spends any time with me knows that like my mom is like a driving force in my life. But she, you know, her health was never that good. She was born with some, so I was in and out of hospitals all the time growing up. And I actually think a lot of the reason I think about God is because I imagine that if you lose your parent, it probably feels a little bit like you believed in God all your life. And then one day someone told you, yeah, God doesn't exist. God is dead, right? Like I imagine that might be what it feels like to lose your parent because you've only known life with them alive. And so these are all the things I'm thinking about for Ellie who has lost like, you know, one of her parents. To me, that whole conversation is two very smart young women talking about something in a very deep and real way and not sort of dumbing them down in any way, but it I don't know, there's like a level of emotionality to it that I personally find very interesting.
Intimacy and vulnerability as well between
yeah.
You mentioned diversity, and Ellie and Aster happen to be minorities. They're both outcasts in a way, but you know, they both have different ways to deal with that notion. Can you tell us about why was it important for you to showcase two young ladies that that one is Latino and the other one is Chinese American?
Yeah, no, it's a really great question. So the Chinese American immigrant aspect is just one that's very close to my heart since I grew up with young immigrant parents. So that one has to do a bit with, I love immigrant stories. I think they're probably maybe the most American stories you can tell. So the choice to make Ellie a Chinese American immigrant was, you know, partly just based in my own life. But the choice to make Aster a Latinx, she could have been white. She could have been, right, you know, like so that was a little bit more of a deliberate choice, but I actually feel like it strengthens the story for this reason. I was very specific about the point that Aster had to be a US born Latinx. And with my casting directors, I was like, listen, this shouldn't be, because there's such a stereotype of the sexy Latina, right? Like I was reading all these, I kept getting these like very sort of, I mean, I don't know how to explain it, but it felt very like, gosh, I in my personal life, I have a lot of US born Latinx friends. And just because they speak Spanish at home doesn't mean that they weren't born here. You know, like that's actually part of the culture in America. Like that's a very American thing. And I kind of want to subtly show that, like she and her dad are both born in the US, you know, like even though they might speak Spanish sometimes amongst each other. But it also was very specific in terms of the way Aster and her dad can sort of, like this whole notion of passing, where they can somewhat pass and yet they can't totally pass. And I want to play with that because then there's Ellie and her dad who can't quote unquote pass at all. Like they're the immigrants, right? Like, and they're treated as such. And there's a way that it could seem on the surface, like, look, you know, Aster's family so accepted in this community, right? Except that they're not totally. And I think there are gradations of how our society approaches both immigrants and POC. And I kind of loved showing some of the nuances of that, that like even just a tiny moment that peeks through is when they're in, you know, they're at the her boyfriend's home and her dad suddenly turns to her.
And she tells her, the dad asks her to sit up?
Yep, in Spanish. Says like, sit like a lady in Spanish, right? And I was like, anyone who's ever like is POC or immigrant who speaks is immediately gonna get that moment where it's like, we all have to put up appearances for the white people. Like we better look good, right? And it's not, it's very benign. It's not like a big gigantic statement. It's just part of the fabric of our, when I say benign, I mean, it's not like it's some big, you know, huge thing or no one's like angry about it, but it's like, it's just woven to the fabric of how we grew up. That if you come to this country or you're POC and you live in this country, there's still a sense sometimes of like needing to like represent. And I wanted to just, you know, just cause it's something I relate to and I happen to know a lot of people who do.
Right. I mean, I mentioned to you that I'm Latino and I came here to the United States as a young man. And that was the moment in the movie that I finally relaxed and I said, this is authentic. And it was just a little brief moment where the dad tells her, sit up straight. And it, I mean, I've experienced that. It was very poignant and you blink and you miss it, but it's so true and powerful. I'm wondering about the fact that it's set in Washington. You could have done it in Los Angeles. You could have done it in an urban area. Instead, you choose the small town in Washington. What was the importance of that?
Yeah, so you're absolutely right. This frankly could have been set in a big suburb in the OC or in, you know, in New Jersey and been like a big sort of, you know, a much bigger, broad sort of teen comedy that'd be super fun. It's like girl, like helps guy get girl that she likes. And it could be a very sort of fast paced sort of romp. And I don't go that direction, right? Like I think the thing I do is I take commercial hooks and I like to show characters you don't usually see, right? And in this case, right as I started to write this shortly after Trump had been elected. And I had already had this idea for the Serrano High School thing years ago, but just was not writing and was doing nothing with it. It was just in the back of my head. And so when I finally sat down to write it, Trump was elected. I was honestly, I was just emotionally devastated by that. I was just like incredibly devastated, as a lot of people were. And I think for me, it was probably because I'd sort of, honestly, I'd sort of bought into this idea, you know, maybe because of my life, you know, coming out as a senior in college, every year of my life, it felt like the world was getting a little more open. Like a few years ago, by Ellen would have a TV show, you know, oh, something else would happen. Now, like, it just felt like, oh, people are becoming more sophisticated in the way we think about homophobia and the way we think about racism and the way we think about immigrants. Like it somehow felt like things were progressing, that we, America as a country, was, you know, like the direction was forward. And when Trump got elected, I think it really caught me off guard that there were large sections of our country that didn't necessarily hold as a value that we work on. I guess what I'm saying is I know, obviously I know homophobia, racism, sexism exist, right? Mm-hmm. But I just assume, like, and I still hold some of those attitudes, even though I'm an Asian lesbian. Like, I don't think it's possible to grow up in this country and not have been imbued with those attitudes. I just hope that over time I've gotten better and better, and I still work on it, right? And my assumption is we all think that's important. But there are whole sections of the country that don't necessarily value that. And I think, as somebody who fundamentally, or maybe I just want to believe that most people are actually decent, that most of us, given the resources, would do the kind thing, right? Like, that was startling from the standpoint of thinking, well, does that mean I now believe all these people are bad people? And I just couldn't wrap my brain around that, because it was devastating enough that at a certain point I really kind of looked inside myself. And if I'm honest, I grew up in a small conservative Chinese family, and my parents were very, you know, they were definitely racist and, you know, and somewhat sexist and definitely homophobic. They've come a long, long, long way. Like, that was the 70s. But because of that, like, I don't, like, do I think my parents are bad people? I don't. They're really genuinely good, good people. And so that made me think, well, that is possible. It is possible to have these attitudes and be a good person. Like, I have to believe that, which made me think, well, in the context of this story, Paul is the representation of that, right? Like, I spend a lot of the movie, and Daniel Deamer does a beautiful job in this. You fall in love with Paul. Like, you spend a lot of the movie, like, first you're like, who's this guy? And then as the movie goes on, you start to, like, you know, and then he breaks your heart. Like, there's a moment that he just breaks your heart. And I needed that, because I needed us to suddenly go, what? How could he can't possibly think that. But the thing is, he can. Good people can have attitudes that can hurt you, you know, or hurt, like, and that's, you know,
questions that the fact that you believe that there is good in all of us, is that the reason why there is so much hope in the film? There is a great sense of optimism in your film and hope.
I'm glad. I mean, I like to think it's still grounded in reality. But yes, I fundamentally, you know, like, I can be sarcastic. I have kind of a dry sense of humor, but I'm not cynical at all. Like, for whatever reasons, I'm just not cynical. And I think it comes through my films, that I don't need the ending to be happy. And in fact, in this film, I definitely am getting, part of the reason people are clamoring for sequels, they want an answer. Like, they want to know this person marries that person, right? But that's not what this movie's about. And also, these kids are 17. I'm like, are you kidding me? But the thing is, they want to know, well, then, okay, what happens 10 years from now? And my thing is, I don't need the ending to be happy like that, but I do need to feel like growth has happened and that this journey has a resolution. And that resolution for me needs to have some hope. Like, I'm just not somebody who feels the need to take people through a journey where at the end it's like nihilistic and awful. Because honestly, I can turn on the news and watch that. So I already know horrible things happen in the world. So for me as a filmmaker, my goal is to get people to a place where at the end of it, you feel a sense of being connected to humanity, right? Like, however that plays out for you. And so that's,
yeah. Your ending, because it is not an ending, is actually, I fully understood that the three of them are starting something. Mm-hmm. It's not starting something that is together, the three of them, but that independently, they figure out who they are by their heartbreak, and now they're on their way to start their lives.
Yes. Yes, that's exactly right. I'm so happy you got that. That's exactly right. And I think that is hopeful, like as you said. I think it's like the, I don't know, my characters are like my children. And so you want the best for your children, you know?
You may, in my other follow-up question was about Daniel and casting him. You talked about how you at first we are not falling in love with him, but there's a point that all of a sudden how tricky was casting Daniel?
Very tricky. I mean, look, I'll be super honest. This is true on Saving Face too. They got like, I love my casting directors, but man, I am like, I'll be the first to admit that I am not easy to cast for because like, I'll be super polite about it, but I will be like, still not seeing what I want. I need to see more people, right? Like you will not believe how many people I will watch and watch and watch until I get like, and I'm looking for any central quality that I feel like is right. And one wouldn't have thought that the role of Paul would be that hard to cast, but I think it's because I just want to make sure it'd be very, very easy to play the role of Paul for a joke. And in fact, I know this because the vast majority of actors who came in to read the role played the role very like, you know, like they played the funny. And I actually hate it when people play the funny. Like there's very few moments in my film where it's like, I'm going for the joke now. Usually I really am like always play for the emotion first. If there's funny, the funny will resonate a lot harder because we feel something for you, right? And the thing about Daniel, and I remember this because I was like, you know, I've auditioned so many teen stars and what that I'm like, oh, I knew I wanted fresh faces, but look, if a teen star had come through that would be perfect for the role and was really great for it, maybe, but I didn't see that. And then one day I happened to see like a tape of this, like, it was like, here's a kid from Canada. And I'm like watching him and I was like, who's that kid? You know, and I kind of like, cause my casting directors didn't bring him up. They were like, well, we think like that. And I'm like, but what about this kid? And so then I was like, I want to talk to, like, I had a Skype call with him and then he self-taped a second thing, which I saw. I thought like, hey, I feel like he kind of, you know, I see, when we talked about the character, he kind of got some of the, he himself naturally goes hyper serious. And I just needed to see that he could go light and he was able to do it. Right. And, then we had I met him in person. I flew out to LA and he came down, we had a read. And I mean, there were a lot of people that we could have gone with, but for whatever reasons, my heart just went out to Daniel. And I think all three of them are fines. But since we're just talking about Daniel, I needed somebody who just exudes a certain kind of goodness. And Daniel really is somebody who does. Like, he's really that kid. He's much more book smart than Paul. He's not Paul in that direction. But Daniel's just genuinely good. And I was like, if we don't have that, then I don't have the emotional punch I'm looking for in this movie. And I think a lot of people, when they read the script, were not realizing that was gonna be an emotional punch. They were like, this is a fun journey. Like, this is Cyrano, it'll be fun. It's like Cyrano of teens, hooray, right? And I don't think they realized till they saw the cut of my film, they're like, oh, this is actually a very deep emotional journey. Like this is, and I was like, yeah, I'm not really making, like I tend to make the kind of comedy where I want you to cry. And if you haven't cried, I failed, right? Like I'm really leaning harder on the humanism than I am on the comedy. And I don't know, that's sort of for me that maybe just works better.
Speaking of humanism, you start as with Plato, then Camus, Albert Camus is brought up and No Exit is also brought up. Can you tell us about that startup?
Yeah. I mean, but part of it is playing with the fun of these are things that you read in high school. And it's so funny to me because you think about the things that we read growing up. And I'll say for myself that, you know, like we read these things way before I think we're even aware what feeling romantic about someone is supposed to be like. Like we're watching movies, we're watching, you know, like early books about like, you know, like we're given these templates of love, right? And it feels like when you look at it, a lot of times, all the old sages, it just seems like everyone is basically telling you how you find your other half or what love is supposed to be about. And so I kind of loved the idea of this extremely intellectual, heady girl who's just living, like she just basically lives in her head. Other than that, she's just getting stuff done. Like she's trying to make sure her dad is going to be okay. She's not really thinking beyond how does she make sure that like to make no trouble in this town and that her dad is going to be okay and that life is going to be fine. But secretly, she has this very rich, just a very rich intellectual life, right? And I kind of love that here's a girl who basically, she's writing papers for other people, but she's also using other people's words to describe love, right? So all these quotes, they're all everything is, it's using other people's ideas of what life is and what love is to get to, like, towards the very end is when she finally figures out, like, her journey is somebody who eventually figures out how to use her own words to describe love. Right. And in fact, you even see it where the first time she attempts to write a love letter, she has zero idea what to do. And she ends up like plagiarizing from Wings of Desire, right? Because she's like, no one's gonna, I'm gonna use this thing. That sounds good. And like gets called out on it. And so now, and I think that's key because now she's sort of forced to have to really write what, like, you know, it's just to modify it slightly to make it sound like it's Paul, but basically she's writing her own true internal feelings. And that process eventually helps her when she gets heartbroken. Like eventually it helps her get to the place where she can describe love for herself. And I think that's really her arc.
You keep mentioning Saving Face, which you did which was released 15 years ago. And I encourage everybody who's listening to this that if they haven't seen Saving Face, they need to check it out. I think you've alluded a little bit what happened, but how come we had to wait years for a follow-up to Saving Face?
Well, okay, I'll say this. I mean, there are practical things that happen in my life, but there's probably going through this process, maybe because I've been asked a number of these questions, I can also sort of see, like maybe there are themes outside myself or forces that also, you know, conspire to make certain things happen. And I think, so the practical answer is that after Saving Face came out, because I didn't go into making that film thinking I want to be a filmmaker, I literally went to that film seeing if I could get that film made, knowing that the chances that film was going to get made was extremely tiny. So when it actually happened, I didn't have like a follow-up plan. like that film, A, who thought that film would get made? B, that film got made and did far better than I expected it would. And when people are like, what's next? I was just like, I don't know. Like, and so I was getting, you know, scripts were being sent. I was meeting people. Mostly it wasn't stuff that it felt that emotionally grabbed me. But every now and then I would come across a project that seemed interesting. And so I'd write for hire. Let's say it's like, oh, here's a book to adapt, right? And that was fun. But writing when it's not your project you originated is a different kind of skill. And it's one I can do. It's just not the most emotionally fulfilling. So in the midst of this, like, so for a few years that was happening, I just sold a TV project to ABC. Based on my experiences as a woman in tech, and the writer's strike hits. So the writer's strike, we're not supposed to write. And just as the strike was starting to pull to a close, my mom had a major health event. So I dropped everything and went to San Francisco, which is where I live now, thinking I'd just be there for a few weeks. And then it just became one of those things where it's like, oh, well, maybe it'll be a little longer. And then after a while, I think I hit this place where I realized that to leave now, it's just because of my relationship with my mom and how close we are, I knew that I needed to live near her. Like that was just what I needed to do at this point in my life. And at that time, it's not like I had so much cachet that I could be somebody who's like, I'm not gonna be living in the industry and taking meetings and I could continue to work. Like I felt like, well, I think moving to San Francisco for me and how all-encompassing what was happening in my personal life was, I think I've just left the industry. And I wasn't as sad as one would think it would be. I was kind of like, well, honestly, I feel incredibly lucky that I got to do what I did in my, you know, in the previous few years. And that chapter's closed. You know, that was my 30s. I was 39 at the time this happened. And I thought, well, my 40s will be about spending time with my family. And I was lucky that financially, I had had two careers and I'd saved enough money from both careers. I really could live off, like, you know, if I invested wisely, I could sort of live off my savings, because I honestly don't actually cost that much. So it was one of those, yeah, I mean, it's just one of those lucky things. So given that, I that's what I did. And it wasn't till about, I guess maybe now it's almost 3.5, 4 years ago, I got pulled back into the industry by a studio exec who we'd become friends, and she'd always wanted to work together. And she got a job at DreamWorks Animation, and out of the blue, she wrote me and was like, are you still writing? And I had not been writing at all, but I literally had just started writing weirdly that month that she emailed me. And I was like, oh, super weird. So that's what happened, is I wrote a script for her and that went well. And it got me back into my writing brain. And then I ended up thinking, like, well, I've never written something for myself to direct. So that I started to write the half of it. And here we are. But the other way to answer that question that I'm sort of becoming aware of is, you know, and it's funny, if you ask my agents, I think they're sort of amused by the other day I was saying to one of them, like, because, you know, they send me a bunch of stuff and I pretty much end up saying no to everything, right? Sometimes, and not because the projects aren't worthy, because for me, if I'm going to work on something, if I'm going to pitch for something, I want to feel like I could possibly be the best person to do this. And if I don't feel that way, then why am I wasting someone's time, right? So because of that, I generally, like, I love reading, but I generally just don't, like, I don't respond unless I respond hugely. And I was actually saying to one of them, like, I don't remember what it is we were talking about, but she was just kind of like, you know, Alice, the reality about you is you're never going to take something unless you really love it. So what is this weird fiction of, like, what if you accidentally, like, take something that, like, you know, because I think I was sort of saying something about, I have my own personal things I'm working on, but what if those take a long time? Do I, you know, and hearing her say that, it just made me laugh, because I realized it is really true of me. And so if you look at these years, those are not exactly years people are banging down my door to be like, can you make another thing just like Saving Face? Those were years people are banging down my door to be like, fantastic. Now, can you do this big studio thing, right? And I'm not against that, but it isn't necessarily the thing I love the most. And so I think where maybe the world is changing now, and I didn't realize it when I started writing the half of it, but now having made the half of it, is there seems to be a lot more room for people. Like, now when I take meetings, people are like, wait, what are you working on? They're much more interested in my personal projects than necessarily trying to mold me into something else. And so I think there's probably a layer of that as well. Like, had Saving Face come out today, like, if everything had been moved, maybe there would be a world where I would have continued to work or write while, you know, being here with my mom. You know, hard to say.
What inspired this film? I should have started with this question instead, is one of the last questions.
Oh, no worries. The thing is, I think a lot of it is, it's funny because I think a lot about love. I mean, I think I grew up reading about, you know, I read a lot of books. I was only allowed to watch classic movies or Chinese soap operas. And I think I sort of bought into this idea that finding your other romantic partner is literally the number one thing you need to do in your life. And that once that happens, your life, like, all the pieces fall into place and, you know, you're complete. Like, you find your other half, right? And as I've gotten older, I've sort of discovered that even when that does happen, or, like, even looking at my friends, when they have, you know, they found a wonderful person to marry, let's say, it doesn't really seem like, and then their life finishes after that. And it's just like fantastic rainbows and, you know, champagne for the rest of their lives. It does seem like, and then, you know, and then life continues. So given that, I've been thinking a lot about like, huh, why do we exalt romantic love as the most important love? When in reality, if I really think about it, sure, I've had some really hard heartbreaks romantically, but I've also had some really hard, difficult heartbreaks between like in a friendship or with a parent, right? And sometimes those heartbreaks have been far worse. And when I think about it, saving face was really dealing with a heartbreak between me and my mom and her having a difficulty accepting me as gay. And this was the germ of the idea started from my realization that my first really huge heartbreak after I came out to myself was actually over a friendship with a straight guy who just a really wonderful person who really helped me when I was coming out, accept myself when like my family wasn't talking to me. And but because I think we weren't that sophisticated in thinking about what friendship is and the world wasn't, like they look at, okay, you're a girl, you're a boy, you apparently seem like soulmates, you should therefore be romantically engaged. But we weren't. Like, what happens if you meet your soulmate and you have absolutely no interest in, you know, you have no interest in having sex with them, right? I think it, things can get confusing because you start to I don't know, there's a way that like over time those friendships can fritter because it's sort of, and when I think about it, that like that was just one of the deep heartbreaks, but I didn't really know how to process that. Like if you date someone, even for just 6 weeks and you break up, your friends are all like, oh my God, are you okay? Is everything okay? But if you're like, yes, my incredibly, where like this is happening, people are just kind of like, yeah, that's sad. But it's not like there's like a process where we all acknowledge that as a break. Like it's confusing. I think we're still trying to figure it out as humans. So that was the place I started from and thinking, well, I want to write about love from the lens of like a lesbian or like sort of a queer straight friendship, right? But in the process, then it's like, it ended up, the film ended up taking on its own sort of thing, eventually became something plot-wise totally different, but emotionally at the end ends up actually being bizarrely emotionally true to what my initial intention was.
And Alice, one last question. What would, now that the film is out, it's in Netflix, what would you like your audiences to get out of your film?
Oh God. You know, it's, I mean, it's certainly I have things that, you know, I have things that I would love. I would love it if someone finishes watching this and this is gonna sound so trite, but truly I do just want them to feel like if they finish watching it and it makes them just call someone they love or call someone that loves them. If they just have that desire to connect with people. But the truth is I don't like now that the film's out, it's really just not mined anymore. You know, now it becomes part of it. It becomes whoever watches it, like that all becomes part of the conversation. So a lot of it for me at this is sort of fascinated seeing what the cultural conversation is that's erupted where people have, you know, maybe they're happy about this, maybe they're disappointed about that. And those things are all valid. So I guess I'm just happy that people, you know, like, of course I want them to feel fulfilled by watching something, but if they aren't, but they're talking about it, then for me, I'm like, well, that's good because yesterday, maybe you weren't talking about, you know, being an immigrant who's being bullied, or maybe you weren't talking about feeling seen as a queer kid. And if today you are, then that's good.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you so much, Alice, for being with us today. I could have gone on talking for another hour.
No, thank you so much for your questions. I really, truly, when I heard you wanted to have this thing, I was so excited because it's a festival that, you know, I mean, well, yeah, you guys have
I'm
tremendous
a big
taste.
Fan, and please do not let us wait 15 more years for your next film.
It's a little bit above my pay.
Something
I'm working on. I have a few things I'm starting to write, and we'll see if one of them gets to a place where I think it's worthy of trying to bring to the world. Then I'll try. But thank you.
Well, thank you so much.
And no, thank you
for listening to us. Goodbye.
No, thank you, Roger. Bye.